First Timothy, the second chapter, start with that verse, and maybe we might go to Acts 17th chapter from there. It's good to be in Bible study and actually study the Bible, not to come talk about how we feel, what we heard, what I think. But it's good to get a word from the Lord. My pastor used to say, it's getting late in the evening. And the sun is going down. We're not all at the same place, but I just need to know where I am. And I'm knowing that at 68, and how fast 20 years passed. I don't have a whole lot of 20s to go. We get ready to celebrate 20 now, but I just don't want to be ignorant all my life. What I come to find out, Tara, is that ignorance is something that many times people choose for one reason or the other. Sometimes, you know, my daddy told me, he said, the truth will make you free, but it'll first hurt you. And so sometimes it's more comfortable to be ignorant. People are lazy. It's certain things a lazy person not supposed to have. And you're wrong if you give it to them. The Bible says that the diligent soul shall be made fat. And if you really want something, you should be willing to do what it takes to have it. And if you're not willing to do what it takes, I say I wanted a degree, a college degree, but I wouldn't get up out of the bed and go to class. I went to the school, I registered, I bought the books, but something else you had to do. You had to get up and go, and that I wasn't willing. And when I became willing, it happened. And so today, I want to know God. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 2nd chapter and the 4th verse, let's go back to the third verse, maybe get a running start to see. I'll start at the first verse. Here Paul, talking to Timothy, tells him, I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplication, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, which would be Christ Jesus, who will have all men. How many men?
All.
Who will have all men to be saved. So then God is not willing that any should perish, but that all would first be saved. But saved is simply a reconciliation. Being saved, we found out and learned that being saved is not coming up, taking a chair. Mm-hmm. Being saved is not something that you do, but it's something that God does. I come to find out, Shonda, that nothing that God does is dependent on anybody else. Nobody can handcuff God. Nobody can, you can't say that, well, God would have if y'all had. You see, we're in error when we say that. If the people would just act right, if people would do this and that, then God would bless the land or whatever. You cannot stop the God that I serve. Amen. Because he is something that's called sovereign. Yes. And what that means is that he has no need of no cooperation. He has no need of... One thing I like about being a solo practitioner, one thing I like about my job is... I don't have to get Negroes together in order to get something done. Do you know it's hard to try to get everybody on the same page before then? What happens is y'all end up meeting all the time and never getting anything done. God does not have to consult with anybody. That should have made two or three of y'all happy. Because they don't want you to have what God got coming for you. They don't want you to be blessed. They don't want your children to go through the doors that they went through. But God decided. And he didn't just decide it when your children got here. Because my Bible says, before the foundation of the world, we were accepted in his beloved. not accepted on our own, because without him we can do nothing. But through Christ we can do all things. All things are possible. So in the salvation, God made salvation possible. Ephesians 2:8-9. For we are saved by grace. Nothing. You see, God operates out of love. And so then, in his love, before we ever got here, God made a way. He went to the cross and he died, and his blood paid the price in order to reconcile us, Mr. Thomas, back unto him. But there's a catch to it. The only catch is that I must believe it. Because he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. So then my part, Fred, is believing the gospel, the good news, the Paul's gospel, the gospel that says that his blood, his sacrifice, would justify and reconcile, would forgive sins that I never could have been forgiven of up under the law. That's in Acts the 13th chapter. So then God wants all men to be saved, but that's not the end, beloved. The scripture says he would have all men to be saved and then to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Let me tell you something. You're not going to stumble up on the truth. You're not going to stumble up on the truth. Give me John 14:6. So then he wants us to be saved, Lady Deborah. Yeah. But now salvation is not. And what, where they keep you. See, Satan is, you're saved, but he don't never want you to come to the knowledge of the truth. Mm-hmm. So then if his whole purpose is to keep you blinded. I said John 14:6. Here Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So he don't want you to know the one. You see, this is not a set of rules and regulations. This is not some kind of commitment that you made to a denomination or to a pastor or to a church. This is the way, not a way. This is the way, the only way. You can't get to the Father. He said, no man come unto the Father except through me. And if you try to go any other way, you are a thief and a robber. You never know me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. There's no life. The Bible says that in him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the darkness comprehended, but it comprehended it not. Darkness cannot keep light out. It can be as dark as it want to be in here. If you flip that switch, it is not dark anymore. So then he is the truth. Give me Ephesians 1:13. First, God bless you, Mother Nun. First, God wants us to be saved. He said he would have how many men? All men to be saved. And then, after you saved, to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Now, I had to get past this peer pressure. The one thing sure ain't my business. And that's how you feel about me. You ain't getting nothing done sitting around wondering how somebody feel about you. You're not getting anything done. You're not helping yourself one bit. And you can spend your life trying to make folk think you wonderful and all that. At the end of the day, ain't nobody thinking about you. Especially if you run out of peanut butter and jelly. When you run out, they run out. Let me see. Maybe I need to go back to 11. It's in Ephesians. Let me see if I can find it. Ephesians, Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians. Okay. Ephesians 1. It says that we should be. Okay. Let me start at verse 11. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance. I'm saved, but I need to come to the knowledge of the truth. I believe that it is a powerful thing when a person knows who they are.
Amen.
I just believe that there's power in that. Now, many times, because of the ups and downs of the vicissitudes of life, you ain't going to look like who you are. Sometimes, and that's when you have to get over embarrassment. Sometimes you go through things that if you don't look like, you don't smell like, you don't act like, and so that's why, especially during those times, you need to know that you know that you know. Look, let me tell you something. Them old folk wasn't just saying something. When they held their hands up and they said one thing about it, I know I am a child of God. They were saying that from the depths of their soul, because they were going to jobs where they were treated. They had little kids and stuff talking to them like they was kids, and they was working for just about nothing, and they were seeing their own husband and things talk to like they was child. But when they got before the presence of God and the Holy Spirit began to deal with them, they was able to cry out from the depths of their soul and say, I know I am a child. Somebody else would catch the refrain and say, I've got a feeling. Everything is going to be all right. You need to know who you are. That's the reason Paul says that God, our Savior, would have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth.
All right, all right.
I'm in Ephesians right here in 1:1 and 11, but I need to jump over to 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, about the 4th verse, real, real fast. And please help me to get back to where I am. But I need to show something right here, because we're in Bible study.
Yeah.
Paul here says, therefore, seeing we have this ministry.
Yeah.
I tell y'all all the time, y'all blessed that God gave me to y'all.
Yeah.
Now, I needed this too. Don't get me wrong. Don't get it twisted. I'm getting benefit too, but I'm telling you, you can't get this on every street corner. No. He says, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, faint not, quit wearing. I'm going to tell you something. If you are on the quest to find knowledge, you're going to be talked about. You're going to be set aside. You're going to be, they're going to hit you where it hurts.
Yeah.
They're going to hit you where it hurts. You think it is and think it that. And if you think of nobody else, no, y'all, they got y'all brainwashed. But no. I'm looking, as in, Acts 17 chapter and 11 verse. The Bible here said, Paul said, those that were in Thessalonica, they were more noble than those that were in Thessalonica, those in Berea,
right.
Because they search. That's all I want to do when I come here. I know y'all have to do some other things, and I go along with you and everything, but really the only reason I come here is to come to the knowledge of the truth. I made a post the other day, said, I don't come to church for nothing but to learn.
Right.
I said, you know, I can go to the crack house and to the bar and place if I want to feel good. They got some places that I'm telling you, they give you instant feel good. I didn't come here to feel good. I came here to learn, and I'm glad to know that Paul said that God, our Savior, he desires that all men be saved.
Yes.
Now, he did that.
Yes.
But I'm the one that's going to have to come to the knowledge of the truth.
All right.
I got to want the truth more than I want you to like me.
Right.
I got to want the truth more than for you to talk. And I come to find out that it's a beautiful thing to be by yourself.
Amen.
I come to find out it's a beautiful thing. You know what? If you be by yourself more often, when you come in contact with people, you'll have more substance when you come. You won't be empty-headed like them. Just sitting up, making up conversation. I ain't talking about nothing. You'll have something to talk about.
All right.
Go to the woods and come back with the goods. God always, always calls his servants aside.
Yeah.
You remember Jesus? The Bible says that a great while before day, they were sleeping. He was up seeking his Father for direction.
All right.
Uh-huh. Even when Jesus went into his ministry, the Bible says, not the devil, said the Spirit drove him into the wilderness, preparing him for his ministry. Well, Moses, when Moses was getting ready, he took him up into the mountain there for 40 days. And so when Paul came off of the Damascus Road, and he went back to Ananias' house, the Bible says that he stayed in the deserts in the wilderness there in Arabia for 3 years. Mm-hmm. They are getting a revelation. God wouldn't let him go to Peter, Paul, because he did not want this revelation to be contaminated with what he had told him.
Yeah, all right.
He was preparing him. I know he was lonely. I believe he had a wife. I believe he had a whole life there. But for God has got to become more important than anything. Anything. And God says that now I saved you, but I want you to come into the knowledge of the truth. Yeah. The truth of what? Yeah. Well, John 14 chapter already told us that. He said, I am the truth.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. You got a Savior who loves you. You got a Savior who, that when everybody else done walked off and turned their back, you got a Savior that when look like you are nothing but an abject failure, when your marriage has fallen apart,
yeah,
you've been fired again off of your job, everybody looking at you said, you got a Savior,
hey,
that says, he hollers out of 8th chapter of Romans, and he says, for we know,
yeah,
that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord and called according to his purpose. Yeah, Cricket,
yes.
I went back up to Fayetteville this weekend, and I was up there, and I told the guys, I said, you know what, I wish I had done like y'all, stayed in school and hadn't got kicked out and all that and graduated with y'all. I said, but you know what, if I hadn't got kicked out of Fayetteville, I wouldn't have went to Arkansas State University. If I hadn't gone to Arkansas State University, I'd never met Deborah Blaine. Let me tell you something. God is in the mix. And just like Joseph said, what you meant for evil, God meant it for good. What you saying, Pastor? What I'm saying is, while the devil may be punching you upside your head, and it look like you ain't making no progress, and look like you're backing up, I want you to know, he don't know that he's backing you up right into your blessing. Right where you... I got Bible on. The Bible says that if the princes of this world had known, they never would have put Jesus in top of that. They would have, if they could have got the news, somebody could have texted him or telephoned him, said, please don't put him there. He had told them, but they just didn't believe him. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto
him.
Take him at his word.
Yeah.
He doesn't. He says that man is going to have to give account of every idle word.
Yes.
God don't speak no idle word. And that's the reason that David has said, as messed up as David was, David says, in your law do I meditate day and night. What it mean by meditate? He said, it ain't coming to me right now. But I know if I stay here and I look at it and I read it, sooner or later, I'm going to see what you're saying. You ever been like that? It was said to you years ago, but you kept meditating on it. And you said, now I see. I see now. He said, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. What is he talking about? He's talking about our hearts. Yeah. Jeremiah says, the heart is deceitful above all things. Who can know it? Your feelings, how you, your heart and everything will make a bigger fool out of you than I ever will. Let me say this right here. Ain't nobody made a bigger fool out of me as I have.
Yeah.
He says, not handling the word of God deceitfully. What does it mean? What that means is that when I see the light, you see, his light is, his word is a light and a lamp. And you can't go nowhere if you ain't no light there. You stumbling and falling if you walk in the dark, but his word is a light. So then his word lights up what I used to couldn't see. But now, the Jeremiah said, when you search for the old path and when you find it, walk therein. So what that means is that you got folks that are so uncircumcised at heart and so stubborn and so prideful that you can show them with the scripture and they still won't accept. You're having the word deceitfully. And that's what Paul said, talking about those that were preaching another gospel, even though there is no other. He said, let them be accursed.
Yes.
Let them be accursed.
Yes.
If any man preach any other gospel, you're handling the word of God deceitfully. This is so important. Because you're lighting the way to people's life. You can't stop them from being saved. Because God does that.
Amen.
But you won't help them to come to the knowledge of the truth. What I love about the truth is that once you see it, you can't unsee it. I know I just said something right there. I don't have to worry about folks. And that's the reason I say, folks, say, you post too much. I hope I keep posting it to family, you see it. I ain't on that just because just to get it. I'm trying to show you something that your pastor won't show you. And you know what? If you keep seeing it enough, and I put a scripture behind it, God might grant you grace that you might see this. And once you see it, Brad, you can't unsee it. He said, not handling the word of God deceitfully. He said, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Look at verse 3. But if our gospel, the good news, the knowledge of the truth, be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. You know you can be saved but lost? Oh yeah. I give you a type and a shadow of it. You remember how those folks came out of Egypt? God brought them out. He brought them with mercy through the Red Sea. And he brought them there, but what happened? Many perish in the wilderness. This is in Hebrews, the 4th chapter. He said, don't be like them, harden your heart in the day of provocation.
All right.
That although I brought them out, he said, I swore by myself that they shall never enter into my rest. Y'all, I was saved 25 years before God gave us Manasseh. But I was not in God's rest because I had never come to the knowledge of the truth. I had. But once that I came to the knowledge of the truth, then I enjoyed Sabbath. Then I could lay in his arms. Then I knew that my salvation was not dependent upon me and my actions or my behavior, but my salvation was totally dependent upon the efficacy of the blood that was shed by Christ Jesus. So God not only wants you to be saved, but he also wants you to come to the knowledge. He wants you to be able to operate in this thing. Why is that? Because he has given you the victory. But the victory is not in you, not in your flesh. We are not of those that have confidence in ourselves.
All right.
But we have the mind of Christ. Because if we walk in the Spirit, we shall not fulfill the lust of your flesh. But religion tells us that we ain't got no lust in our flesh. Religion tells us you saved now. You ain't supposed to act like that. Ain't nothing changed. Paul says, I consent with my mind that the law is good, but I find within my members another law warring against my mind. I thank God that I can read and believe the word of God now. It ain't no jackleg preacher gonna turn me from God. It just ain't worth it. Handling the word of God deceitfully. You know what the word said, but you're preaching man's doctrine. Doctrines of devils. Keeping people bound up. Jesus told the Pharisees, he said, you know what? He said, you cross land and sea in order to bind up folks just like you bound. He said, what you got is the blind leading the blind, and both of you gonna fall in the ditch. But I used to hear men say, well, a woman's so fine, he said, she's so fine, if she go to hell, I'm going with her. But I don't feel that way. I don't care how fine she is, you got to go by you. I ain't in no danger going to hell. But I tell you what, I do know what it feels like to be saved and miserable.
Yeah.
I do know what that feels like. You're saved, but I'm telling you what, you're perishing in the wilderness.
My Lord.
He says, the God, the little g of this world, have blinded the minds of them. You see, we have an adversary. Peter said, we have an adversary, the devil, who goes about as a roaring lion, seeing whom he may devour. One of his attack zones is your feelings. And that is why that he wants you to come to church, and the whole time in church, he wants somebody shouting at you with your feelings. No substance, ain't gave you no scriptures to hold on to, just dealing with shouting for your feelings. And also, the singing over and over the same thing. He made it all right. He made it all right. He made it all right. You got nothing to fight the devil with. See, the devil don't respect nothing but the word of God. And that's where when Jesus was in the wilderness, Jesus turned and he gave him the word of God. He didn't tell him, you ought to leave me alone and I ain't done nothing. I'm Jesus who I am. No. He didn't. Satan even questioned, and you're going to be questioned. And that's the reason you need to know who you are. Mother Nun, Satan will bring the closest person to you.
All right, Val.
In order to make you doubt who you are.
Yes,
and that's the reason the old saints used to tell us to stay on your knees.
Yeah.
See, we talk too much now.
Amen.
We stay on the phone.
Amen.
But you stay on your knees.
Yes.
Come apart from all this conversation. Because most of it, you're talking to empty.
Yeah.
You're just talking to empty folk. They don't mean no harm, but these folk pastors ain't teaching them nothing.
Yeah.
They just ain't. And you can't go any further. It's a dangerous thing when folks talking about, well, you know, I don't believe everything my pastor said. No way. I read my Bible for myself. Okay. Well, if that's true, what that means is that your pastor has a vision and you have a vision.
Yeah.
And what that is that's division. That's division. And how can two walk together except they be agreed? I asked God over there cleaning up one day. I said, God, why you didn't show me this while I was over there? Because I didn't know all this. Right? He said, look, he said, just like, he said, show me that little roof over there. He said, you can't get no higher than that roof, can you? I said, no, I can't. He said, look, he said, I can't let you get no higher than your leader. He said, I'm not the author of confusion. I'm not the author of confusion. That pastor got one vision, one understanding, and whatever. That's when I don't let him come over here and preach. Because you're not going to come over here with another. Paul said, no. He said, if you preaching any other gospel, that which you have received, he said, let him be accursed. And then he was just amazed at the folks who went for it. Like, I'm amazed sometimes when people leave here and go back to them. I'm like, I guess they ain't learned nothing. Because I go back even to visit, and I sit up there, and I try not to be like Gene. Because Gene would like, you could see the look on Gene. Gene will do one knee right here. Just, Gene, don't do that. That's so ugly. Don't do that. So that's one reason I just don't go. But I'm sitting up there, and all the time, I'm thinking in my mind, that ain't right. No, I ain't got time to sit up and listen to something that I know ain't right. I'm sorry. My wife can tell you, I like to be productive. Whatever, if I got some time, I won't be trying to do something.
All right.
During that time, I'm not the guy that want to sit around and twiddle my thumb and be lazy and whatever. I'm trying to get ahead. He says, lest the light. And the reason they want you to blind your mind, see, it's the will of God that you be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. But if he can blind your mind, because why? What is he trying to keep you from? Trying to keep you from the light of the glorious gospel of Christ. Take me back to Acts the 17th chapter. Lest the light of the glorious of who is the angel that's just shining. Back to Acts the 17th chapter. Okay. Boy, these 20 years went fast. Acts 17th chapter. And 22nd verse, here Paul says, then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, you men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious, or religious. Okay. Put a pen there. Let's go to Galatians 1. Galatians 1. We almost through. This is good stuff. Mm-hmm. That's good stuff right here. See, I asked God. I said, God, show me the way. Mm-hmm. He did it. What you're walking in now is what you prayed for.
Yeah.
Now, let me tell you something else that Satan will do. He will try to cause you, because of other people, he will try to cause you to minimize or feel little of what God has done for you.
Yeah.
That's right, every now and then, you need to look back.
Yeah.
Not to go back. But look back so you can see from where God brought you from. Not from that. Now the Bible said they that compare themselves with themselves are unwise. And now, even though Lady Deborah and I have been together since 17, 18 years old, I don't know like she know what the Lord have done for her. Just I don't know. I have some idea. But I don't know. Like, see, don't nobody know like you know. The lonely hours. They don't know the confusion in your mind. They don't know the ways that God made. They don't know the traps that God helped you to walk around. They don't know the things that God blessed you not to. Not so much what you did, but what God blessed you not to do.
All right.
God. Yeah, let me go to Galatians 1. Galatians 1, maybe verse 7. Galatians 1, maybe verse 7. Sounds about right. Let me go hurry up there. Yeah, I know Pastor Sonny got over. I can't move as fast as that. He says, here Paul says here in Galatians 6, he says, I marvel that you are so soon removed. See, what you must understand, that everybody does not have the steadfastness that you have. They don't have it. Because you see, it's one of two things. Either they hadn't got that just right like you did.
All right.
Or possibly that it did not have the effect. The effect. In my fraternity, they like to brag about how long they pledged. I pledged for 6 months. I pledged for 2 semesters. I pledged, and those were mostly at PWI, predominantly white institutions. At the black institutions, they had more of a hold on it than they had it. I tell them, I said, I pledged 18 days. Could have pledged one. What they did that one day convinced me I was open. I ain't got to come back for no another year. I know y'all mean business. That one day was goodness. Everybody does not have the steadfastness. But the strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. So God has given you strength to hold on, old soldier. Because they're watching you. You might not pastor no church or whatever and everything, but they're watching you. And let me tell you this right here. They know you ain't like everybody else. You might think, well, they just look at me as old as right here. No, baby. When trouble rises. See who they come to test. Well, can you pray for me? They ain't asking them other folk to pray for them. They asking somebody that they think can reach heaven. He says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from this right here. You on your way. I have given you the knowledge of the truth. I have told you who you are in Christ and all this. And now you've been moved. These folks coming to you, telling you that you got to be circumcised, telling you got to pay tithes, telling you that you got to keep the law of Moses. And I've told you, I preached this gospel to you, telling you that he went and they stretched him wide, hung him high. That he shed his blood upon Calvary's cross. That blood was efficacious. That blood was accepted by the Father as payment for the sin of the world, past, present, and future. The only thing you have to do is place your faith in it. And when you place your faith in it, I also told you, bringing you to the truth, that not only did Christ hang upon the cross, but he told them in Romans, he said, know you not that as many of you as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death, that you died with him, you were buried with him, you are resurrected with him. Remember, I told you that you should set your affections on high, that as a matter of fact, you are seated together with him. Right now, come into the knowledge of the truth. Find out who you are in Christ Jesus. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things have passed away and all things have become new. You need to come into the knowledge of the truth of who you are in Christ. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthened me. I can't preach.